National Spokesperson of BJP and a member of the Nagaland Legislative Assembly, and holds the position of advisor to the government of Nagaland on information technology and communication, new and renewable energy, science and technology. Ms. Kikon has also published 3 books of poems since 2018 and is an Aspen Fellow. Please welcome on stage.
Thank you. I would like to welcome all of you to this very important conversation we're going to have with the Honorable Chief Minister of Arunachal Pradesh, Sri Pema Khandu Ji. As you all know, YLC is about in-depth, intense and engaging conversations. We've had this conversation with the members for over so many years now that we know in and out of each members of the Governing Council. Today, we're going to continue with that spirit. We want to have a conversation about his journey in politics, his initiatives, and also the vision he has not only for a state of Arunachal Pradesh. He has performed, he has delivered, and now we want to also listen to him about the future, envisioning that he may have done, or the issues that he want to take up to take notice further. So that is at the core of our agenda. I would begin by just sharing 2 things about him. One, sir, we are very proud of you because of, from a hesitant entrant to politics, you have brought political stability to Arunachal Pradesh. And as we all know, for any reforms, you need political stability. And he has brought that. And to begin with, I want to ask him about his entry into politics and also why does he always refer to himself as a hesitant entrant to politics, sir?
Once again, Sabiko Namaskar, and thank you, Kikon. Jo question Kikon ne jo yahan pe rakha ki the reluctant politician. In fact, yeah, that's true. Prior to joining into politics, I was into business, especially into construction. I joined active politics in 2011. After that, I became minister of various departments, of which tourism was one of the important portfolios which I had. So in 2015-16, there was a huge political crisis going on in my state, Arunachal. So at that point of time, Arunachal is an assembly constituency. We have around 60. So all the members from different political background, say it from BJP or Congress or the regional party or the independent MLAs, they all have unanimously, brought forward my name that you have to become the chief minister and lead the state. So from 2016 onwards, the journey continues. Thank you.
We all know the journey has been remarkable ever since 2016. So I would like to begin by the period where you were tourism minister. So you introduced and you initiated the Zero Music Festival, which has now become one of the biggest festivals in the Northeast. And I believe from when you organized it, you wouldn't have, or your people wouldn't have imagined that it will become this big. Sir, what has been the main idea behind it and how did you make it successful?
See, Arunachal Pradesh, the beauty of Arunachal Pradesh is tremendous, and it is also the biggest state of Northeast. And when I was into tourism, looking after this department, so I thought, why don't we showcase Arunachal to the rest of the world? Because being a tribal state, we have 26 major tribes and more than 100 sub-tribes. So every year, our community celebration, like community annual event of their own respective tribe is there. But additionally, it should be backed up with some tourism festival. So accordingly, when I was tourism minister, I had started not only Zero Festival of Music, I started the Tawang Festival, the Dambuk Orange Festival, and also Adventure at Mechuka. So these are the, you know, big initiatives that I have taken. So coming back to Zero Festival of Music, it was way back in 2012, where a few of my friends, they have also given a very good idea that we should start and we should promote tourism in different part of Arunachal, also that too in central Arunachal. So Zero was the perfect matching for this kind of festival. Zero Festival of Music is a platform where we promote the indigenous rock songs. All the bands, they can't sing cover numbers. They have to sing their own compositions. So it's a platform for indigenous rock song. And over the years, I'm very proud that as of now, it has become not only a localized or a state tourism festival of music, but it has become international platform. Different band from across the globe, they come there and perform their own songs. So it's a good opportunity for the youngsters who are passionate about music and promoting themselves through music. Yeah.
So just in relation to that, one simple question: what has been the economic idea? I mean, the idea to, you know, whether you have generated enough you know, income for the local people. What about the livelihood, the economy, the sustainability of the music festival? So for governance, these are key issues. So I just wanted to ask you.
Initially in 2012, when I started this Zero Festival of Music, at that time, the local population from Zero area, there was huge objection that it shouldn't be, it should not be promoted, and it should not happen here in our place. It will destroy our culture, ecology, so thing and so on. At that time, I had a meeting with the delegation of that respective area, and I have assured them that in coming days, this festival is going to be a very big platform and tourism attraction will be there. At that point of time, there was hardly any hotels or homestays there in Zero. But now if you go there and see, that area is all, you know, it's coming up with good hotels and there are a lot many homestays. So definitely Zero Festival of Music had a huge impact on the local economy as well.
Thank you, sir. Not many of you would know. And as a legislator myself, we aspire to achieve the same things, but not many of you will know of one of the very, very important achievements in his career as Chief Minister. From Zero Festival, let us say from zero to 8 airports in Itanagar, in Arunachal, he has achieved something which none other, no other states notice have achieved. Sir, how did you do this?
See, you know the history of Arunachal Pradesh. Way back in 1962, we had kind of landing grounds during those times. So unfortunately, during, you know, as time passes, but no one has looked into those infrastructure, no one has thought about, you know, revamping it and making it for public or army usage again. So those airports, those landing grounds were totally of no use. But 7-8 years back, when Honorable Prime Minister Saab has initiated his vision for improvement in connectivity in Northeast as a whole, and Arunachal, we are ready, already having this kind of rough track, but unused. So it was totally funded from Government of India, and as of now, we have 8 advanced landing ground, of which 6 can, you know, 6 airports can be used for fixed wing landing, and 2 are used for heliports. And the biggest airport where we can land big flights like Boeing or Airbus, we have completed one project in Arunachal Pradesh in Itanagar itself. We have got the license, and hopefully this month, October itself, Honorable Prime Minister Saab will inaugurate the Itanagar airport also. And under Udaan scheme, we have already connected 2 airports, Pasighat Airport and Teju Airport also. And Teju Airport have a direct flight from Imphal also as well. So apart from that, in aviation business, under Udaan scheme, we have one, 2 in fact, Dornier flights. I had requested the Ministry of Civil Aviation that since Arunachal, our Itanagar, that main airport will be coming up soon, and since Arunachal is a very spread state, starting from, you know, Bhutan border till the Myanmar border, and in between the Tibet, very long Tibet border. So we have already built 8 advanced landing ground, of which 6 can be used for fixed wing landing. So I had an understanding, and I must express my thanks to Ministry of Civil Aviation, Government of India. So under their initiative, they had asked the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, HAL, to develop a special flight meant for all those small areas, small landing grounds. So accordingly, Ministry and HAL, Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, they had provided Arunachal with 2 aircraft, Dornier aircraft, D228. So once this Itanagar airport is operational, so within this state, there will be a very good air connectivity through Dornier aircraft.
So not only airports, but you even asked for aircraft specifically meant to land in the airports that you have made. So that's a huge achievement. Round of applause for that. The road to development begins with the development of roads. I've been telling this everywhere. And if you go to Arunachal, I've been going there since 1994 as a student. I've seen the transformation has been immense. But even in 2014, I was there. It was not so, the road sector was not so developed as it is now. So in your 6 years, how, what is the amount of money you've been able to bring to Arunachal for development of the roads? Because connectivity is one key issue in Arunachal, being the largest state in the Northeast. And how were you able to ensure that the implementation is as per the criteria laid down? So these are the 2 things I wanted to know, because it's something we all must learn from.
Yeah, in terms of connectivity, road plays a very vital role, especially in the mountain or the hill states. If you talk about statistics, when I took over as chief minister, the total density or the total road network in kilometers, it was around 20,000 kilometers of road only in Arunachal Pradesh. So within these 6 years, now the road network in Arunachal Pradesh, in terms of total length, it was around 30,000 in 2015-16. Now we have added 20,000 more, so now we have crossed 50,000 kilometers of road length in these 6 years. 20,000 kilometers addition. That is because due to the larger vision of the PM sir, which I have already mentioned regarding connectivity, and also the dynamic leader of our Ministry of Road Transport and Highway, Honorable Minister Shri Nitin Gadkari ji. So now Arunachal, you can see we have this Trans-Arunachal Highway of around 1800 kilometers, starting from Tawang, westernmost to the eastern district of Longding, which is also bordering with Nagaland. So likewise, all the district headquarters are being connected by double lane highway, and also our Itanagar, capital area, is also being connected by 4 lane highway. So there has been a huge transformation in road sector, as I have already mentioned. During these last 6 years, 20,000 kilometers has been added into road network in Arunachal.
What about the money invested for all that? How much?
That must be in thousands and thousands of crores, yeah.
Sir, give me an estimate.
Since road, there are many agencies, obviously our own PWD and PWD Highway Division is also there. Apart from there, if you talk about the central agencies, like we have Border Roads Organization, also NHIDCL. So these are the major agencies who are implementing these road projects, and majority of it are being funded by Government of India. And also a very successful program. It is a huge success in entire northeastern state, like during our Bharat Ratna,
the network of roads that you have built. One video which went viral, thanks to Karmaji, was of you driving a jeep, I think, to Vijayanagar. And the road was bad. And then you had promised that you would finish the road in a year's time. Mm-hmm. What's the status now, sir?
That is a very interesting story. Vijayanagar, if you can see the map of Arunachal, there's a long, stretch of land going towards eastern side. So that area is been neglected since very long, let me be very honest. And at that point of time, a project was sanctioned many years back under Pradhan Mintri Gramin Sarak Yojana. But unfortunately, due to some technical lacking or, some problems with the DPR, without having the ground knowledge, something was wrong in that DPR. And the public residing in that far-flung areas, they had to suffer a lot. You won't believe the distance from the district headquarters to Vijayanagar is around 157 kilometers. 157 kilometers from the distance from district headquarters to that area of Vijayanagar. So at that point of time, I went by helicopter previously also, and the public, there are only one point memorandum, ki road ab jaise banana hai. Then I made up a mission that I will, next time I will go by road and I will see what exactly can be done on ground situation. So it took me 2 days by traveling by road, by pushing the jeep, pulling the jeep, and also by trekking for so long. And then I found out the terrain is very soft. Terrain is not like, you know, our from like Tawang, it is totally mountainous rock. Terrain is, in compared to, you know, this terrain was very soft, very mild. Then I, since I'm my background is from road construction agency, so I know about roads. So I have assured the public that within 1 year, this road will be completed. And as I speak now, I'm very proud to mention the Mayo Vijayanagar Road, the stretch of 157 kilometers, is completed now, and roads are more travel now.
Sir, your commitment is highly appreciated, and we would also like to know about the Sela Pass. What's the importance of the Sela Pass? How, what's the status, and how did you envision that?
Since Tawang is the westernmost district of Arunachal Pradesh, and like I mentioned, in 1962, one of the portion of the aggression from Chinese side started from Tawang sector only. So Tawang needs to be fortified very well. The executing agency of that road network starting from Tejpur, Balakpung, Tawang is the Border Roads Organization. So when I took over as Chief Minister, I have called the Border Roads high official team in my office, and we have discussed. I have also called the Army representative as well. So our basic idea is, my question to them was that, ki how can we reduce the travel time, and also how can we reduce the tough terrains? We need to do some innovatives, we need to realign some roads. So discussion went on for some time, and later the BRO also came up with the idea that within the existing alignment, we can come up with some tower, tunnels. So accordingly, I have taken up the matter with Government of India, Ministry of Defense, and PM level also as well. So Government of India was kind enough to sanction three tunnels in this Tawang Road. One, it is in Nijifu, and two in this Sela Pass area. So very soon, I'm hoping by next 2023, by March or April, all these three tunnels will be completed. And once these three tunnels will be completed, the travel time to Tawang will be drastically be reduced.
From
and the journey, no, no, you, from that Tejpur Balakpung Road access, yeah. And the journey will be definitely a very comfortable one. So my dear friends from Northeast and across India who are assembled here, you should visit Tawang once the tunnel is complete.
Sir, listening to you and coming from another state, I feel that the center has been very partial to you. We feel that they've been investing in your state. Is it because of your initiative, or what can be the secret?
No, there are no secrets as such. The thing is that India is a very big country, and your persuasion, you know, follow-up does matters. Yeah, that's the only thing I can say.
And for that, only a committed chief minister will be able to achieve. Do you agree? Sir, I mean, the discussion is about digital governance, but I'll come there because infrastructural development is key to any development policies in any state. So, to continue with that conversation, sir, the railways, nobody thought the railway station will come there to Naharlagan before you took over. Yes. How did that happen? What was the story?
Interestingly, when we mentioned Northeast, you just imagine the whole area Northeast. And I say, Arunachal is the actual Northeast of the Northeast. Arunachal is the exact Northeast of the Northeast. And I belong from an, you know, the mountain area. My people, you know, we didn't imagine that you know, one fine day railway will be also coming to Arunachal Pradesh. So it was definitely Government of India's blessing that as of now we have rail connectivity till our capital area, Naharlagan area. We have direct trains from Delhi and also networks from different states also as well. So the foothill area of Arunachal Pradesh, now the railway has completed few of the portions of survey also as well. Survey has been done in few areas, and rest area surveys are under consideration. So entire stretch of the Arunachal, that foothill area, very soon it will be connected by road. So not only this, as I mentioned, Arunachal shares a very big border with Tibet. Tibet means Tibet, China now. Tibet, China, around 1,100 kilometers kind of border we share. So connectivity will play a major role. So Government of India and Arunachal government, after several deliberations and discussions, we have now finalized to bring railway connectivity more closer to border areas. There's a central Arunachal in which a town called Alo. So from foothill areas to Alo also, one strategic railway connectivity survey is under progress. And another important road network, that is from Chardwar Balapung to Tawang. So till Tawang, we are planning to bring this rail connectivity, and survey is under progress now. So this is a huge, huge leap towards railway connectivity in Arunachal Pradesh. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. I mean, we cannot imagine how much amount of money has been spent by Government of India to ensure that those are achieved. Let's get to the point where, which this also, not many people know. The entire Northeastern region, I'm sure all the chief ministers will be facing the problem of unemployment and how to address those challenges. But especially not in the private sector, in Arunachal, in the government sector, you've initiated a policy reform, which I feel would be your legacy. How did you come up with the idea of having the Arunachal Pradesh Staff Selection Board? What was the thought process behind it? And what is the intended, what's your target in terms of how you're gonna address the unemployment problem through this Staff Selection Board? What kind of transparency level in the governance you're gonna bring in? So these are issues that everyone, every young and old alike are thinking about, but you have been able to demonstrate with your action that what you speak, you will walk the talk. Please enlighten us on that.
Yes, Staff Selection Board was one of the biggest reform which I have brought in Arunachal Pradesh. It is unfortunate that over the years, especially in northeastern states, overall have been a very corrupt kind of practices as well, especially in government job recruitment. So when I was tourism minister, at that time also, especially there used to be a one post of officer, tourism information officer, we call it TIO. So previously what used to happen, department used to conduct the exam, department used to recruit all their staffs and officers also as well. So at that time I had made a decision that from tourism department there will be no recruitment, it will be handed over to Public Service Commission. There were lots of resistance and all, but I said no means no, it has to go to Public Service Commission. And accordingly at that time also we have recruited those officers from Public Service Commission. So I thought that as a political person, that during elections, and it is a practice not only in Arunachal but in lot many states also as well, jab hum log vote mangne jata hai to public bhi, kyunki purana system aisa tha ki they negotiate as per how many votes you have in your home. So accordingly if you have huge numbers of vote, then they negotiate ki aap MLA ban jane ke baad itna naukri humko dena hai. So this was the process, not only in Arunachal, but lot many states. But this should be stopped somewhere or anyhow. Kahin na kahin jaake isko rukawat dalna zaruri tha. So I have deliberated with few experts, and we have came out with a solution. Ki we need to create another recruiting agency for the Group C and Group D staffs also, like Staff Selection Board. तो उसको हम लोग ने जब लागू किया, it was totally welcomed by the public, and now there is no corruption in staff selection board, and especially those parents who work very hard, they go to labor, their contract labor or some casual labor also, their hard earned money they invest on their children, they send them to school, they send them to colleges, having a dream that one fine day our children will be also working in various government sector. But due to the corrupt practice, you know, there is no one to listen to them because they don't have the reach to the political person or the bureaucracy person. So that's why staff selection board was created, and now people are so happy. It is totally upon their own merit. So accordingly, there has been a huge transformation now.
So even you can't influence a candidate to get a job.
No. No,
it is only through merit and only through
yes.
the exams.
Yes.
So do you think this is something which needs to be adopted by other states as well?
Yeah, definitely. Being in you know, from the northeastern part, definitely I would like to appeal my you know, colleagues from all northeastern states that this is a very good initiative, and we should all implement it. Yes.
Sir, I salute you. This is a legacy you will leave behind, and I think and at least my state Nagaland is going to implement that. We are already in the final stages. We will ask him about another 3 questions, and then I'll open for you know, to the audience for questions. Sir, coming back to health and education sector, I've seen that after you took over, medical colleges have come to Arunachal. Now, you know, it will seem to all of you that the development has shot up in Arunachal only after he came to power. So one of the challenges Arunachal had was the political instability. So sir, at a very young age, and for a, you were only a second term MLA at that time. How did you manage to you know, unify and also stabilize the political situation in Arunachal? Just a small peek into your experience.
Like I said, Arunachal, in terms of landmass also, we are the biggest. And in terms of tribe categorization, we are 26 major tribes and more than 100 sub-tribes. So politically managing Arunachal, yes, definitely I agree, it's a very difficult job. Because in Arunachal, like in Nagaland also, there are a lot many tribes. But you have a common linking language called Nagamis, Assamis, Manipur, Manipuri. But in Arunachal, we don't have a linking language called Arunachali. We don't understand each other's tribes, that you know, language and also. To politically, to you know, manage Arunachal is a very difficult job. And surprisingly for me also, it has been just 6 years as chief minister, and I'm counted as second longest chief minister after Gegong Apang. Only 6 years, but I have become the second longest serving chief minister. So you can imagine the instability, political instability that had happened in my state. Many of the chief ministers, they lasted for hardly a few days, a few years. No one has reached 5 years. So, you know, this kind of instability used to happen, but I think with the new national leader, the way Prime Minister focuses and the way the BJP works, I think people have built a confidence in the system, like, you know, now the leadership or the, everything is changing. Now people are accepting that, you know, every year if there is a change, turmoil in political, that thing, then the state will suffer. So our MLAs also, they are working hard, and you know, new political dimension is being, their mindset is changing. So a lot many transformation in political sides also is taking place now.
How responsive are you as a chief minister to your MLAs?
Definitely, see, since all the MLAs are publicly elected, and they are also, they play a very important role in terms of development and all such, I'm very accessible to my MLAs. I have, my WhatsApp number is not only for the MLAs, but the entire states, they have my direct WhatsApp number. Even the public, they call me directly, they send me messages. And within the MLAs, I have my, this WhatsApp group also. Any information, any suggestions that I have to pass on, I pass on through them. And whenever necessary, I travel to their constituency, and I travel a lot, especially during winters, to ensure that the MLAs also, they perform well. And I also ask my public that we are very accountable and a transparent government. You should know which all government programs or schemes are being implemented in your constituency. I've started the initiative for, you know, like publishing in net that which all schemes are going on in every constituency, so that everything is clear. And I request my public also to, you know, see whether monitor also whether it is going well or not.
So what about the, in your health and education sector? First, what's the budget allocation? Has the percentage increased? Number two, what are the innovative initiatives that you've brought to ensure that the health and education sector develops? Because it's one of the most neglected sectors in the region.
See, definitely over the years, the budget allocation to education and health sector has increased a lot. To just give you an overall comparison of the budget in my state, way back in 2015-16, when I took over, the state annual budget was 12,500 crores. 12,500 crores in 2015-16. So as we talk now in the year 2021-22, now it has crossed more than double. Now we have reached 26,111 crores. So more than double we have jumped the budget. And accordingly, all these sectors, the allocation has been improved a lot. And it's talking about health sector. 2 years back when this pandemic, COVID, it broke up. So I had a very close meeting to understand the health dynamics, health system dynamics of Arunachal Pradesh. And there I was also, you know, I was also shocked to see the health infrastructure across Arunachal Pradesh, all not in good condition. Our human resource in health sector was a huge gap of around 33% human resource gap in health sector. So these were a few of the challenges, but after seeing the all these problems in health sector, I had allocated around 500 crores from state-owned budget to health sector. We have supported the health system like revamping of the old structure and, you know, constructing new hospitals across the state. Also backed up with the equipments also, and also with the human resources, starting from specialists to the GDMOs, doctors, and also the staff nurse and everything. So now the human resource gap has been reduced from 33% to 6% only. So it's a huge achievement, and infrastructure every year we are building, like I mentioned.
What about the medical college?
Yeah, medical college was also, it has also come during my tenure only. We have started in 2018. So this was a very big achievement. Previously, our students, they had to go to other states to study medical. But now we have already established the medical college in my state, and I think next year, the first batch will be passing out. So it's a very good thing that we have done in our state.
Sir, what about the school education?
Yeah, education also, since there have been a very big reform in education sector. Like previously when we started schooling in Arunachal Pradesh, since education was very, we had started, we are a late starter in education. So if you talk about post-independence, right after independence, we had only five schools. Only five schools in across Arunachal Pradesh we have started. But now if I mentioned, we have around 3,000 schools, 3,000 schools. But thank you for the clap, but I'm not satisfied. The number is too much for me. Actually, this kind of number is not required to promote education. So what I'm focusing is on quality education. So over the years, it was very unfortunate that when Government of India came up with a very innovative idea, it was good, but the states, respective states who are implementing, they could have, you know, worked out properly how to implement this project. Like for example, I'm talking about this SSA, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan program. It was a very good program. But unfortunately in my state, what happened, it was all, you know, contractual benefit driven scheme. Every kilometer, you know, without any having a proper data, without studying anything, people have constructed schools, you know. तो वहाँ पे क्या होता है कि टीचर्स एक दो वन और टू टीचर्स आर पोस्टेड विथ 10-12 स्टूडेंट्स. तो वो होने का बाद क्या हुआ कि एजुकेशन सिस्टम का आपका वो नंबर्स तो बढ़ गया वो दैट, लेकिन द क्वालिटी एजुकेशन हैज ड्रॉप्ड. नाउ आई हैव स्टार्टेड कि सबसे पहले वी हैव टू मर्ज ऑल दिस स्कूल्स. फॉर एग्जाम्पल इन ए विलेज we don't require 3-4 schools. Even one school, if you club together, you make one school, then it will be much better. Pura teachers jo hai, aap wahan se club karke ek school mein dal paega. And from government side also, it will be, you know, in a better position for government to invest on infrastructure. So likewise, we have shut down around 400 schools, zero enrollment schools, and the merging of schools are also taking place. So that, you know, that we need quality education. So is prakar se kafi sara reforms shuruvat kiya. And this year we are taking up 50 schools with an estimated of around 500 crores to rebuild all those schools. 50 schools we are taking up this year with a budget allocation of 500 crores. So now slowly the education sector is also improving in Arunachal.
Sir, just last question, but to take the liberty, I will club three questions in one question. One, sir, we have seen all the Bollywood stars coming only to Arunachal. They don't come to our states. Sir, what is the secret? How do you, you know, I don't want to use the word, but how do you bring them, entice them to your state? What is the secret, besides the beauty of your state? You put tourism on the world map. Secondly, I've seen that you take all your administrative officers who just passed out as part of the training to Shimla, to Delhi and all that. So that is that your idea? Why, you know, if so, what is the you know, thought process behind it? Finally, I just want to mention as an aside, in Tawang you took the IIM Advanced Training Center, I suppose, branch of it.
Yes, certainly.
So how has it helped your government employees?
One of the biggest thing that we have taken up is with the administrative reformations which we brought into Arunachal Pradesh. And just for the understanding of the audience, Arunachal and Mizoram from the northeastern states, we are the only two states that despite being an independent state, we are still under the Ahmed Carter.
Not Meghalaya.
Arunachal and Mizoram. So, since Arunachal is a very difficult area, so I've been requesting Government of India that Arunachal also needs a separate cadre to address our problem. Government of India is also discussing this matter in the highest level to how to resolve this matter. So, but in between, what I thought is like the senior officers who come from Delhi, from UT cadre as posting in Arunachal, they hardly stay for 2 years. And 2 years, it can't be, you know, it's not possible for an officer to run the show. So what I thought that I should empower my own officers, own public service officers. And with this problem, I went to Lal Bahadur Shastri Academy of Administration, Lavasna, in Mussoorie. So I had a meeting with the director and all the staffs there. So I had told them that you have to empower Arunachal Pradesh by training our public service officers. So this is an history. The Lavasna is an institute where they train only the IAS officers. So Arunachal is the first state we have started from last year that our public service officers are also trained in that IAS institution only. So this is a big achievement. And this year also I went to Lavasna and we have increased the, you know, training module period for Arunachal Pradesh. And this year's batch will be also going there and having the same training. So we need to empower our officers through training and various other initiatives. So regarding your next question regarding IIM, Atul Kulkarni Saab is also here, Director IIM Shillong. So we had a discussion that, you know, especially when I was mentioning the reformations and, you know, empowering our officers. In that point of time, IIM plays a very vital role. So instead of coming all people from Arunachal to Shillong for training and all, I thought like, why don't we have a satellite center of IIM in Arunachal Pradesh? And the team initiated by Atul Kulkarni, the director IIM, they have sent a team, they have done the recce of Arunachal Pradesh, and finally they have zeroed in Tawang. Tawang has the capacity and infrastructure where we can start up the courses immediately. So accordingly, last year we have established the IIM Satellite Center in Tawang, and we are imparting training programs to our government officials, even to the Indian Army, and very soon we're going to impart training to the political fraternity also as well. So this kind of reforms we have taken up. And regarding the Bollywood matter, that's a very secret question that I will answer you personally. just kidding, Arunachal is a very beautiful state. And like my union law minister, Kiranji, is also from Arunachal, and he's also very active in social media. And he also promotes, you know, accordingly. So when he's in center, he's in touch with lot many actor and actress also. So, you know, I push him that, you know, bring some more Bollywood actor and actress. So this is how, you know, there's a special place for Arunachal in Bollywood. And 2 years back, before the COVID outbreak, I had a special interaction with the Bollywood, especially the producers and the directors also in Mumbai. We had a two-day session wherein we have showcased the potentials of Arunachal Pradesh, the beauty of Arunachal Pradesh. So likewise, last year, you know, a breakthrough came over, and very soon a movie will be released called Bedia. Bedia movie, very soon it will be released. It is shot in Arunachal Pradesh only, exclusively in Arunachal Pradesh. We have heard this theme song. We have heard this theme song in which a talented young person from Arunachal Pradesh, singer, K4K. So he's a very good singer, in which Bedia also, you know, he has his number there. So likewise, we are encouraging Bollywood industry to come to Arunachal and shoot, and we are giving certain facilities also to them from the Arunachal government.
Sir, this is not my question. This is a question from my friends who came from Nagaland. So, sir, from one-lane road, now people are seeing four-lane roads in Arunachal. Sometimes some people have not imagined that in their lifetime they will see four-lane roads in Northeast also. So, the question was, sir, why are you trying to show off by bringing, you know, sports cars to Itanagar? Sir, please tell us something about that. After that, I'll hand it over to the audience.
Like I mentioned, you know, when Honorable PM Saab says in his speech, like, ye desh tobhi badlega, ye desh tobhi develop hoga, jo North East develop hoga. So within North East, as I have already told you all, that Arunachal is the Northeast of the Northeast. That means terrain-wise also Arunachal is the toughest terrain. So when things are happening in Arunachal Pradesh, why don't we have it in other states also as well? So last year, you know, the supercars, those sports cars, there's one group. So they came to Arunachal with all those, you know, supercars. They had a ride in eastern Arunachal side around 1,000 kilometers. They had a ride. They spent around 2 or 3 days. So, you know, there is a message that, you know, Northeast of the Northeast states, we can, you know, have good roads with the, you know, we can run their supercars. And very soon they are also planning to take it towards the border areas also, like roads has been developing in Arunachal Pradesh. So in coming days, you can see supercars running into the mountains also as well.
So some rules for the questions. Please state your name, what you do, and ask a specific question. Please don't give a statement or a speech. So the house now open for questions. Please raise your hands.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Okay. Yes. Yeah. Hello, sir. Yeah.
Sir. Your name.
Yeah. Hello, sir. Prema. Oh, and hello, yeah, sir. Kikon.
Yeah. Please.
I'm Bisman Zimek. I'm the president of Tangkhul Trade and Commerce Council, and I'm also the general secretary of BJP. And sir, I'm from Hindu College too.
Oh, acha.
Acha, same college.
Which batch?
Sir, 2002.
Okay, then you are my junior.
Yes, sir, your junior.
Your question.
Hearing your story and all the achievements, it's truly inspiring. So now my question is, like, how do you see Arunachal in 2030? And at the same time, how do you see this Northeast in 2030? As compared with other states of India in respect to economic and also other developmental aspects. Thank you.
Yes, First of all, thank you, my alumni from Hindu College. So Northeast, now things are totally changing and we are witness to it. This is not a political statement, but practically we have seen changes in all the 8 states of Northeast. So Honorable Prime Minister has envisioned when this country will be celebrating the Amrit Kal, that means the 100 years of India's independence. Now we have celebrated the 75 years of India's independence. So after next 25 years, how do you all see your respective state grow? So the focus from Government of India over last 7-8 years was one of the major change factor. Previously, you know, union ministers visiting our state like Arunachal, yeah, Nagaland, Mizoram, yeah, Manipur, it was very rare, very rare. Maximum of the union ministers, they visit till Assam, that too in Guwahati. And, you know, our local papers, they carry a headline that Phalana Phalana, union minister, Northeast tour karke chala gaya. Now, after 2014, PM Saab has directed all the ministries that you all should go to Northeast, spend a night there, you have to conduct your departmental review meeting, and you find out a solution of the problem, and then you come back to Delhi. So every fortnight, one of the union ministers is traveling in each and every states of Northeast. So this kind of approach from union government has brought a huge impact in terms of development in all sectors, which I believe. So in coming years, definitely, if the same momentum, it continues, definitely our youngsters, they have huge talents, and we'll be listening to them also as well. Our experts are also here in today's panel discussion. So we'll be taking out good suggestions from them also as well. Definitely we have the caliber, we have the potential in Northeast. So I see after, you know, 25 years when the country will be celebrating 100 years of India's independence, Northeast will be one of the major contributors in the GDP of our country's economy.
On point of order, one governing council member wants to take the opportunity. Karba.
Thank you for letting me ask a question. Otherwise, only BJP people are getting to ask.
This is unfair.
Yeah. So now,
please don't state your political party affiliation when you ask questions.
So I'm Karma from East Bojo. My question, CM sir, is that, you know, your one of your motto is zero tolerance to corruption, and you have initiated so many cases against people. It seems like corruption is in our DNA across the Northeast, and it's happening. You were so excited with making your staff selection transparent, but recently we saw a question paper being leaked in the APSC exams, which was a very big blot, you know, on the entire government. How do we fight that in future? My second question is that, you know, you seem to have very thin skin. Maybe it's coming from the mountains. Despite so many people attacking you, there are people who attack you openly on Twitter, on Facebook, you do not respond at all. Unlike so many other leaders whose, you know, tolerance level is very low. There are immediately cases and all happening. But you do not react. What is the secret?
Yeah, thank you, Kamala. The first question which Kamala has, you know, asked is a very genuine question. In fact, being from Northeast, like I have already mentioned, Northeast was a kind of neglected area since very long. So there was no proper kind of monitoring system in entire Northeast. So khushi khushi marji wala. So, you know, it has become a culture in Northeast. Now, slowly, slowly, every state is now evolving, because center is also supporting you, center is also keeping a vigil on you, the monitoring system has gone up so high. In my state, I have started geotagging of projects. It may be funded from Government of India, or it may be funded from Government of Arunachal Pradesh. Geotagging system I have started. So slowly things are progressing, and you know, slowly we are all leaving the, you know, the corrupt practice which has been a long legacy for Northeast. So likewise, still there are, you know, corruptions going on in different forms, you know, in all these Northeastern states, and obviously in Arunachal also. It was a setback to me that despite dealing corruption with iron hand, previously Arunachal Pradesh, it was very unfortunate. Like in every state, we have this vigilance department, which is called as also SIC. So in Arunachal Pradesh, SIC was already there, but SIC doesn't have any record. Their register is all empty. They haven't arrested even a single person. Till, you know, when I took over, I have activated the SIC, and now, you know, SIC is very active. My vigilance department is very active. Those officials or those businessmen, whosoever it may be, they are indulged into corruption, so they are, you know, brought behind the bars. And recent, now I think what is happening in Arunachal Pradesh, the main that burning issue is regarding the paper leak scam which had happened, unfortunately, in Public Service Commission. See, now Public Service Commission is an autonomous body that we all agree, but saying so, it doesn't mean that, you know, government has to shy away. So this, when this thing happened, I was totally into shock, and you know, as soon as I got the information and I've activated the SIC, they have arrested, I think, a lot many people, those who are involved. And also to gain the public confidence of that premier recruiting agency, Public Service Commission, I have recommended it for CBI investigation also. So tomorrow I will be meeting Honorable Union Minister Amit Shah Ji in Guwahati also. Therein also I will be requesting him to you know, make it a fast process for initiating the CBI inquiry into this matter. So through this platform of the Northeast Leaders Connect, I want to assure you all and also my youngsters of Arunachal Pradesh that justice will be done, justice will be there, and definitely government of Arunachal is you know, having a very close look into how things are happening, and definitely we need we will do a very big reform in this Public Service Commission.
Second question about the thick skin. Second question about the thick skin.
That I think I have learned from you.
Yeah. Name and.
Sir, this is Vikal. I am the founder CEO of Eka Care. It's a health tech startup. I'm a developer, coder, technologist. I'm a big fan of your work. Two of my very close friends are from Arunachal.
State your question.
Yeah. So, what do you think in your vision, digitization, where is it? And how do you think in such a kind of a state where you have like difficult terrains, telemedicine, teleconsultation, tele-education, all of that, how will it help? And what is your vision?
Thank you. In fact,
supposed to ask that.
Yeah, in fact, he forgot to ask about the main theme, you know. Today's conversation was regarding the e-governance and IT solutions, but thank you for taking the main question.
I got sweat by his stories.
The digital transformation in Arunachal Pradesh, you know, is happening now in a very big way. PM Saab has launched this, you know, digital technology, you know, whatever things, you know, it should be connected with digital technology. We should use digital technology. So likewise, Arunachal Pradesh, we are the first from Northeast. We have started this e-office also. Wherever I travel right now, I'm in Imphal, I can, you know, access through e-office and I can dispose all my files. So as of now, we have created around more than 15 lakhs e-files. So accordingly, all district, it has started from secretariat, started from chief minister's office, then it went to secretariat, then to all the directories. Now it has been implemented to all the districts of Arunachal Pradesh. So now, once this e-file system, if we introduce, it's a very transparent thing. Earlier, when what used to happen, corruption lies in the file. So, you know, जो फाइल जो मूव करता है बाबू कुछ लिखता है ऊपर पहुंचते पहुंचते वो नोटिंग भी चेंज हो जाता है कागज भी चेंज हो जाता है बट इन ई फाइल सिस्टम वंस दिस डॉक्यूमेंट्स इज स्कैन एंड इट्स एंटर्ड नो वन कैन टिंकर ऑल दोस डॉक्यूमेंट्स इवन इफ यू हैव टू टिंकर इट विल बी ऑन रिकॉर्डेड लाइक टूडे यू नो द 7th ऑफ अक्टूबर Chief Minister Pema Khandu has downloaded this document. He has inserted this new document. Everything will be recorded there. So it's a very transparent way of governance which Arunachal has bought, and we are number one in Northeast, and I think 17th in the entire country. So likewise, the government of India has been very supportive in to implement in this project, and in terms of network connectivity, the SWAN project is going on in Arunachal Pradesh, and every month I used to conduct e-Pragati with all the deputy commissioners. I give them advance notice that which all projects will be discussed there from your district. So accordingly, they visit the ground and they give me the real information. So digital technology has brought a huge transformation in Arunachal Pradesh, and also our assembly, also we have this e-Vidhan. So this is a totally less paper, I won't say paperless, I will say less paper e-Vidhan system in Arunachal Pradesh. And you know, you talk about medicine, this time also honorable, due to the vision of Honorable Prime Minister, he has focused on the drone technology. And Arunachal being a very, you know, very difficult terrain, this year in 15 August, we have launched the medicine from sky with in collaboration with the drone technology, where in emergency medicine can be carried by drone and dropped in that respective area. So yes, digitally Arunachal is transforming a lot.
So last two questions from the back.
Hi sir, I'm Kalpana from Manipur. I'm a program coordinator of NRLM. So we have certain schemes that primarily look for rural development. So when we work in your state, there are certain funds which your government hasn't approved. And those funds are like very much needed for developing community leaders from the rural part of Arunachal Pradesh. It is as a whole for notice as well. Every state has state rural livelihood mission. So particularly coming to your state has not approved certain funds that is like holding the community leaders development. So can you throw us some light on your APSRLM work so that we have a clear idea how is it functioning? Thank you so much.
This is an important question. In my keynote speech also, I have reflected how to empower, you know, how to change our rural economy with reference to the self-help group. So in Arunachal Pradesh, we have, you know, constituted lot many self-help group, and the women folks, they are very actively taking part. As rightly mentioned, regarding the SRLM projects in Arunachal Pradesh, we have coordinators all across Arunachal Pradesh. They are mobilizing with the self-help group. They are also training them. And in coming days, I don't know where there is any problem or not. If there is, then definitely it would be taken care of from the concerned ministry.
Yeah, you.
Hello. Sir, yeah, I'm here. Good afternoon, sir. My name is Chipemia Bonme, and I'm pursuing my master in mass communication at Manipur University right now. Like you said in the previous, Northeast India areas is very rich in culture, in forests and nature resources, but still there are no major industries. And these industries are one of the main source of employment. In regarding this issue, what are the things that the elected leaders need to do more and focus on?
Thank you, very good question. You have rightly pointed out that Northeast, we are lagging behind in terms of industry and all those areas. To understand the business of industry, the bottom line is that, you know, an investor will, you know, it's not a philanthropic job. Definitely he will see, he will calculate, he will do, you know, a big calculation that how much profit my company is going to earn. And to that some point of time, I think due to connectivity was a major hurdle for entire Northeast. Now it has been is being addressed in a very good way. So slowly, I think that industry will definitely flourish in Northeast and in my state also as well. But saying so, we should be very careful, like which kind of industry do we actually need? Northeast, since maximum of us, we are all from tribal areas. And tribal people, they are very closely associated with their culture, with their nature, with the forest. So we must be very careful in choosing industrialization, which kind of industry are we ready to take care. So back home in Arunachal Pradesh, we have discussed upon this industrialization matter. Since our road communication has improved, rail connectivity, as I have mentioned, is improved a lot. So slowly, from the industrial side, many of them are wanting to invest in Arunachal Pradesh. But we are going for the green investment. Those industry who doesn't pollute much. So that kind of industry only we welcome in our state. And definitely, I think the rest of Northeast also, they might be having the same vision. But definitely, yes, industry will come up very soon in Northeast.
So the question hour is closed. I'm very sorry, I've been instructed to immediately close the question hour. But we can continue this discussion later on. I want to thank our Honorable Chief Minister for spending so much time with us. Also, most importantly, for ensuring that every question is respected and replied to according as we all know, his character is such, he's a very responsive, hands-on leader. And this is the kind of leadership we want in the Northeast. And for not only legislators, but also for all the youth of Northeast, we consider you as a youth icon for all of us. Continue to lead us. And we wish you all the best in the days to come. We want you to surpass Gekong Apan's record and continue to have political stability in Arunachal, which will be good for all of us. Thank you so much for listening.